Recorded Books presents Masters of Atlantis by Charles Portis, narrated by Jefferson Mays. Young Lamar Jimmerson went to France in 1917 with the American Expeditionary Forces, serving first with the balloon section, stumbling about in open fields, holding one end of a long rope, and then later as a telephone switchboard operator at AEF headquarters in Chaumont. It was there, on the banks of the Marne River, that he first came to hear of the Gnomon Society. He was walking about Chaumont one night with his hands in his pockets when he was approached by a dark, bow-legged man who offered to trade a small book for two packages of old gold cigarettes. The book had to do with the interpretation of dreams. Corporal Jimmerson did not smoke, nor did he have much interest in such a book, but he felt sorry for the ragged fellow and so treated him to a good supper at the Hotel Davos. The man wept, overcome with gratitude. He said his name was Nick, and that he was an Albanian refugee from Turkey. After supper, he revealed that his real name was Mike, and that he was actually a Greek from Alexandria in Egypt. The dream book was worthless, he said, full of extravagant lies, and he apologized for imposing in such a way on the young soldier. He apologized, too, for his body odor, saying that nerve sweat or fear sweat made for a stronger stink than mere work sweat or heat sweat, or at least that had been his experience, and that he was always nervous when he spoke of delicate matters. Perhaps he could repay the kindness in another way. He had another book. This one, the Codex Pappus, contained the secret wisdom of Atlantis. He could not let the book out of his hands, but as an adept in the Gnomon Society, he was permitted to show it to outsiders or perfect strangers who gave some promise of becoming Gnomons. Lamar, who was himself an entered apprentice in the Blue Lodge of the Freemasons, expressed keen interest. It was a little gray book, or booklet, hand-lettered in Greek. There were several pages given over to curious diagrams and geometric figures, mostly cones and triangles. Mike explained that this was not, of course, the original script. The original book had been sealed in an ivory casket in Atlantis many thousands of years ago and committed to the waves on that terrible day when the rumbling began. After floating about for 900 years, the casket had finally fetched up on a beach in Egypt, where it was found by Hermes Trismegistus. Another 9 years passed before Hermes, with his great powers, was able to read the book, and then another 9 before he was able to fully understand it, and thus become the first modern master of the Gnomon Society. Since those days, the secret brotherhood had seen many great masters, including Pythagoras and Cornelius Agrippa and Cagliostro, but none greater than the current one, Pletho Pappus, whose translation this little book was. Pletho lived and taught in the Gnomon Temple on the island of Malta with his two adepts, Robert and a man named Rosenberg. Lamar was embarrassed to say that he had not heard of this society, nor was he aware that flotsam of any description, literary or otherwise, had ever been recovered from Atlantis. What was the book about? Mike apologized again, saying he was bone tired. Could they continue their discussion another time? He could hardly keep his eyes open, and must now find himself a dark doorway where he might curl up and try to get a little rest. But Lamar would not hear of this, and he arranged for Mike to be put up in the Hotel Davos. Their friendship flourished. They had many meals together and many long talks. Lamar paid for Mike's food and shelter and cigarettes, and even bought him a cheap suit of clothes. Bit by bit, the truth came out. Mike confessed that his real name was Jack, and that he was an Armenian from Damascus. He was here on a mission. Pletho, with an eye to expanding the activities of the secret order to the new world, had sent him here to Chaumont disguised as a beggar to look over the Americans and determine if any were worthy of the great work. So far, he had found only one. Lamar was embarrassed again. But Jack insisted that, yes, Lamar was indeed worthy, and must now prepare himself for acceptance into the Brotherhood. Lamar did so. First came the Night of Figs, then the Dark Night of Utter Silence. On the third night, a wintry night in room 8 of the Hotel Davos, Lamar Jimmerson folded his arms across his chest and spoke to Jack the ancient words from Atlantis. "Tell me, my friend, how is bread made?" And, with much trembling, became an initiate in the Gnomon Society. This work done, Jack said that he was at last free to divulge his true Gnomon identity. He was Robert, a French gypsy, and he must now hasten back to Malta to report his success to the master, the success of the American mission. He would leave the Codex Pappus in Lamar's care for further study, and as a kind of token of good faith or surety, and he would return in a month or so with more secret books, with Lamar's ceremonial robe, and with sealed instructions from Pletho himself. There was a $200 charge for the robe, payable in advance. This was merely a bookkeeping technicality, one of Rosenberg's foolish quirks, and all rather pointless, seeing that Lamar would begin drawing $1,000 a month expense money as soon as his name was formally entered on the rolls. Still, Robert said, he had always found it better to humor Rosenberg in these matters. Lamar saw no more of Robert and heard nothing from Malta. He wrote letters to the Gnomon Temple in Valletta, but got no answers. He wondered if Robert's ship might have been torpedoed or lost in a storm. There was no question of his having run off with the robe money, because he, Lamar, still had the codex, along with Robert's poma, a goatskin cap he had left behind in his room. This poma was a conical cap signifying high office, or so Robert had told him. The armistice came, and many of the doughboys set up a clamor to be sent home at once, though not Corporal Jimmerson, who remained loyally at his switchboard. He even volunteered to stay behind and help with all the administrative mopping up tasks so as to replenish his savings. In May 1919, he received his discharge in Paris and went immediately to Marseille, and got deck passage on a mail boat to the island of Malta. On arrival in Valletta, he took a room at a cheap waterfront hotel called the Gregale. He then set out in search of the Gnomon Temple and his Gnomon brothers. He walked the streets looking at faces, looking for Robert, and clambered about on the rocky slope surrounding the gray city that sometimes looked brown. He talked to taxicab drivers. They professed to know nothing. No one at the post office could help. He managed to get an appointment with the secretary to the island's most famous resident, the Grand Master of the Knights of St. John of Jerusalem, but the fellow said he had never heard of gnomons or gnomonry, and that the Grand Master could not be bothered with casual inquiries. Lamar found three Rosenbergs, and one Pappus in Valletta, none of whom would admit to being master of gnomons or perfect adept of hermetical science. He tried each of them a second time, appearing before them silently on this occasion, wearing his poma and flashing the codex. He greeted them with various gnomon salutes, with his arms crossed, with his right hand grasping his left wrist, with his hands at his sides and the heel of his right foot forming a T against the instep of his left foot. At last, in desperation, he removed his poma and clasped both hands atop his head, his arms making a kind of triangle. This was the sign for need assistance, and was not to be used lightly, Robert had told him. But Pappus and the Rosenbergs only turned away in fright or disgust. Was he being too direct? A man who wishes to become a Freemason must himself take the initiative. His membership cannot be solicited. With gnomonry, as Robert had explained, it was just the reverse. A man must be invited into the order. He must be bidden to approach the master. Perhaps he was being too pushy. He must be patient. He must wait. Just at that time, at the sidewalk cafe outside the Gregale, with the cries of seabirds all about him, Lamar met a young Englishman named Sidney Hen. Sidney was keeper of the botanical gardens in Valletta, and as such had been exempted from war service. He too was curious about things. Not only was he a student of plant life, but he also collected African artifacts, spears and leather shields and such, and he read strange books as well, and speculated on what he had read, hoping to piece together the hidden knowledge of the ancients. The two young men hit it off fairly well, particularly after Lamar had let slip the fact that he had in his possession a book of secret lore from Atlantis. They walked along the quay together, sometimes arm in arm, though Lamar found this European custom distasteful. They talked far into the night about the enigmas of the universe. Sidney kept after Lamar to show him the Codex Pappus, and Lamar kept putting him off in a polite way, saying he was not sure under what conditions he could properly show the book to a perfect stranger. Lacking immediate guidance from his superiors, Robert and Pletho, he was not sure just what he could and could not do. He would have to think it over. "And quite right, too," said Sidney, who did most of the talking on these dockside rambles. He had strong opinions. The Freemasons had gone wrong, he said, through their policy of admitting every Tom, Dick, and Harry into the lodge, and the modern so-called Rosicrucians were not the true brethren of the Rosy Cross, far from it. And this stuff from India, this Eastern so-called wisdom, was a complete washout. He had looked into it and found it to be a quagmire of negation. It looked sound enough, and then you thumped it and it gave off a hollow ring. On Sunday afternoons, Sidney presided over a kind of literary salon at his hillside villa, which was ablaze with flowers the year round. Lamar, told that he would not feel comfortable with such people, was never invited. Then, one Sunday, he was invited. Sidney said, "Come on up and meet the gang, Lamar." Lamar was not favorably impressed by all the slim, chattering young men at the gathering, nor they with him. But the food was good, and Sidney's sister, Fanny Hen, a crippled girl, was kind to him, very attentive. When he returned to the Hotel Gregale that night, he found that his room had been ransacked. Nothing, as far as he could tell, had been stolen. His poma and codex were still safe behind the loose board in the linen closet. Probably children looking for war souvenirs, he thought, and he was careful to stuff his puttees and some other things behind another loose board. The next morning, just as he stepped out into the street, something came whipping past his ear like a boomerang. Careless kids throwing a marlin spike around. Later that same day, at dusk, he was assaulted on the street. He was walking around a corner when a man struck him full in the mouth with a long wooden oar and knocked him flat. As he lay there in a daze, Two or three men were suddenly all over him, handling him roughly and ripping his clothes in search of something. Waterfront thugs, he later decided, who had taken him for a rich American. The laugh was on them. The sunny days passed, and the warm nights, and Lamar ran out of money. No word came from Robert or Pletho. Time to take stock. He was a Gnomon initiate, with a hidden master, a book he couldn't read, some 30-odd stitches in his lips, and no robe. He did have his poma, but when to wear it? He looked about town for work. Sydney said he might be in a position to make a personal loan against the Codex Pappus. Lamar said it would hardly be fitting to mortgage the Codex. The only job he could find was one cleaning boots and emptying chamber pots at the Gregale. There was no pay, but he did get his meals and the use of a cart in the basement. The Gregale guests, mostly English poets and Greek honeymooners, were poor tippers. Now and then, a poet would fling him a threepenny bit. The Greeks, when they left anything at all, left tiny brass coins in their broad shoes that could not be exchanged. But these Greeks, brides, grooms, chubby merchants, were quite generous in another way. They translated the Codex Pappus for Lamar, a page or two at a time. He allowed no single Greek to see much more of the book than that, being fearful lest the entire text be exposed to a perfect stranger. The pages of handwritten English accumulated. At length, the work was finished. Lamar bound the leaves together with a shoelace and began his study. He sat on the cart at night, wearing his poma, and labored over the hard passages, reading a sentence over and over again in an effort to wrest some meaning from it as he brushed away on the high-top yellow boots of the poets. In later years, in his introductory remarks to Gnomon aspirants, he was fond of saying, "Euclid told the first Ptolemy that there was no royal road to geometry. And I must tell you now, gentlemen, that the road to Gnomonism is plenty tough, too." He committed the entire work to memory. All 88 pages of Atlantean puzzles, Egyptian riddles, and extended alchemical metaphors. He knew every cone and every triangle by heart, just as he knew the 13 hermetical precepts and how to recognize the three secret teachers, Nandor, Principato, and the Lame One, should they make one of their rare appearances before him in disguise. Soon, he began to wonder if he might not be an adept. He became sure of it one afternoon when he overheard a remark in the street, "Don't worry about Rosenberg." That is, he did not become sure of it at that moment, but only a little later, as the words continued to ring in his head and swell in volume. This, surely, was what he was waiting for. The sense of the message was obscure, but there could be no doubt that the signal was genuine. This was Pletho's oblique way of communication. As an adept, he now felt free to put the whole business before Sydney with a view to bringing him into the Brotherhood. Sydney had come to doubt the existence of the book from Atlantis, and he could no longer receive Lamar, a bootblack, socially at Villa Hen, but the two young men still managed to see one another on occasion, behind the giant ferns at the botanical gardens or at one of the low waterfront cafes. So it was, at a sidewalk table of the Café Gregale, that Lamar told Sydney the full story of Robert, the Codex, Hermes, the Poma, the translation, the voice in the street. Sydney heard him out, his skepticism giving way to excitement. He looked through the two booklets, one Greek, one English. He read Greek, though with difficulty, forming each word slowly with his mouth and on the bilabials blowing little transparent bubbles that quivered and popped. Then he turned in impatience to the English version and read hungrily. "This is marvelous stuff," he said in a fairly loud voice. "I can't make head or tail of it." He had to speak up over the shouting and scuffling that was taking place in the street. It was some political disturbance that did not concern them. Sydney wanted to take the books home and study them at leisure, but Lamar said he could not, at this time, let them out of his hands. Trying to soften the refusal, he pointed out that the Codex was largely incomprehensible without the keys that Robert had revealed to him. These keys were never to be written. They could only be spoken from one gnomon to another. Sydney became agitated and demanded to be given the keys and taken into the society at once. Then he sighed and asked Lamar's pardon. He took Lamar's hand between his two hands and begged that allowance be made for his short temper. He had been a very naughty boy. The only thing now was for Lamar to move into Villa Hen, where he could live in that comfort and peace so necessary to the scholar, and give instructions in this great work in the proper way. Lamar accepted the invitation, and the next day he carried his bag up the hill to the villa. Fanny Hen, the crippled girl, was not around. He asked about her, and Sydney said he had moved her into a boarding house down the way so that Lamar might have her room. But Lamar would not hear of this, and the girl was soon restored to her room. Lamar slept in the library. Fanny had made no very distinct impression on him before, apart from her kindness and her game leg. Now he began to notice other things about her. She was small and dark like her brother, but there the resemblance ended. Where Sydney was moody, Fanny was sprightly. And where Fanny was open, Sydney was sly. She had been an army nurse, and her right knee was stiff from shrapnel wounds received in the final Flanders offensive of September 1918. She wore billowy shirts with striped neckties. Sydney was an apt pupil, much quicker than himself, Lamar had to admit. He cut short his work at the botanical gardens and came home early each evening, flinging his black cape carelessly from his shoulders and quickly slipping into his red silk dressing gown, eager for another long session with Lamar in the locked library. He smoked black Turkish cigarettes and sipped Madeira. From time to time, he rubbed his hands together. When he had grasped a gnomic point, he would say, "Quite," or "Quite so," or "Just so," or "Even so," and urge Lamar to get on with it. The progress slowed somewhat when they came to the symbolic figures. Sydney found himself in a tangle with these cones and triangles. He often confused one with another and got the words slightly wrong. During the day, Lamar enjoyed the company of Fanny Hen. They discussed their war experiences. He expressed regret that he was not free to tell her, a woman, about gnomonism, except in very general terms. But there it was. He was under certain vows. She said she understood, and that after all, women had their little secrets too. He told her about Gary, Indiana, carefully pointing out that his people had nothing to do with the steel mills. She talked about girlhood escapades at the Grange, Little Fen-on-Sea, which was her home. They sat at the piano and sang Beautiful Dreamer. They went to the harbor and watched the boats and ate Italian sausages. She made light of her silly knee and apologized for being such a slow walker. Slow or fast, he said, he counted it a privilege to be at her side, and would consider it a great honor if she would take his arm. In little more than a month of intense study, Sydney became an initiate in the Gnomon Society. Within another month, he was an adept, And then, as a peer of Lamar's, he began to speak out on things. He suggested how the course of study might be organized along more efficient lines. The ritual of investiture could be improved, too. A processional was needed, a long, solemn one, and more figs and more candles, and some smoldering aromatic gums. Lamar agreed that such touches were appealing. The innovations seemed harmless enough, and might even be useful. But how could two adepts presume to do such things without direct authorization from Pletho Pappus or some other master? Then Sidney Hen uttered the thought that had been troubling Lamar for some weeks. It was a wild thought that he had often suppressed. "Can't you see it, man? You're already a master. We're both masters. You still don't see it? Robert was Pletho himself. Your poma is the cone of fate. You and I are beginning the new cycle of gnomonism." So saying, Hen produced a poma of his own, one he had had run up in Red Kid, and then, like Napoleon, crowned himself with it. Thus boldly expressed and exposed to the blazing light of day, the thing could be seen clearly, and Lamar knew in his heart that it was true. He was master of gnomons, and had been master of gnomons for perhaps as long as 6 weeks. He had not, however, suspected for one moment that Sidney might be a master too, and this news took his breath away. What was more, Sidney said he believed himself to be a hierophant of Atlantis. Lamar was puzzled by the claim, there being no such title or degree in gnomonism, to the best of his knowledge. Over the next few days, Sidney outlined an Alexandrian scheme whereby he and Lamar would take gnomonism to the world. He, Sidney, would be responsible for Europe and Asia, and Lamar would establish the ancient order in the Americas, in accordance with Pletho Robert's plan. There was no time to lose. He all but pushed Lamar out of the house, saying he was terribly sorry, but an unsecured personal loan was out of the question. He must make his way back home as best he could. Lamar, as a veteran in distress, was able to get a hardship loan from the American consul upon surrender of his passport, just enough to pay steerage fare to New York in the sweltering hold of a Portuguese steamer. Fanny kissed him goodbye at the dock. And so the rough accommodations bothered him hardly at all. Lamar was hardly noticed as he passed through New York with his codex and continued on his journey home by rail. In Gary, he picked up his old job as clerk in his uncle's dry goods store. He took his meals and his baths at the YMCA down the street and slept in the back of the store. Here, in the shadowy storage room with the drop light and the cardboard boxes, he established pillar number one of the Gnomon Society, North America. He was unable to recruit his uncle, who said he didn't have time to read a lot of stuff like that, much less memorize it, nor did Lamar have any luck with his old school chums. His first success came with a traveling salesman named Bates, who set up pillar number two in Chicago. Bates was followed by Mapes and pillar number three in Valparaiso, Indiana. Mapes was a football coach, ready to try anything. He hoped that gnomonic thought might show him the way to put some life into his timorous and lethargic team. Mapes was followed by nobody, for quite a long time. Three pillars, then, and three members, all told, and that was what Lamar had to show for almost 2 years of work. By this time, he had made a typewritten copy of the Codex, The string-bound manuscript version was getting dog-eared and did not make a good impression. The typewritten copy did not make a much better impression, but it was easier to read. Lamar could see that many men did not accept this as a real book either, judging from their hard faces as they flipped through it, pausing over the triangles and recoiling and then giving it back to him. What was needed was a properly printed book. Bates told him about a Latvian newspaper in Chicago where, in the back shop, English could be set in type and printed without anyone there understanding a word of it. Lamar went there and ordered 50 copies of the book and asked the Letts not to break the plates, but to keep them readily available for reorders. The books had blue paper covers and were bound with staples. Some years were to pass before the first printing was exhausted. The 1920s were later to be celebrated as a joyous decade, but to Lamar, it was a time of the grossest materialism and of hollow and nasty skepticism. No one had time to listen. Fanny Hen's letters kept him going. Her monthly letter, lightly scented, was the one bright spot in his gloomy round. She was now in London with Sidney, or Sir Sidney, he having become the fourth baronet on the death of his father, Sir Billy Hen, the sportsman. Sidney was disappointed in his patrimony, which amounted to little more than a pile of Sir Billy's gambling debts, but he had pushed on with that energy characteristic of the Hens to set up his Gnomon temple on Vay Street and, according to Fanny, was doing quite well with it. Lamar kept Fanny's current letter in his inside coat pocket, where he could get a whiff of it with a slight dip of his head, and where it was handy for rereading over his solitary meals. In his replies to her, he always enclosed a money order for $15, and said he hoped she would use the small sum for some little personal luxury she might otherwise deny herself. In the spring of 1925, Lamar went on the road as a salesman, working out of Chicago under Bates with a line of quality haberdashery. It was a good job, and at first he did well with it. So well that he was able to make a down payment on a small house in Skokie and a transatlantic proposal of marriage. Fanny accepted, against the wishes of her mother, who was worried about Chicago gangsters, and of brother Sidney, who stood to lose an unsalaried secretary. She arrived at New York on the Mauritania. Lamar took her to Atlantic City, where they were married in a Methodist chapel. The honeymoon was delightful. From their hotel room high above the beach, they could watch the battering waves. They took rides together on the boardwalk in the ridiculous rolling chairs and had late suppers at Madame Yee's, with tiny white cups of tea. It was the last carefree time the young Jimmersons were to know for several years. Fanny Jimmerson was fond of her brick bungalow in Skokie, which she fancied to be in the exact center of the continent, and she might have kept it had she not unwittingly stirred up the embers of Gnomonism. Lamar no longer talked much about the Gnomon Society. Repeated failure to interest others in the secret order had worn him down. He no longer bothered his fellow drummers in hotel lobbies with confidential talk about the cone of fate. Now, here was Fanny telling him of Sidney's great successes in London. He had brought hundreds of men into the Brotherhood, including some very famous members of the Golden Order of the Hermetic Dawn, and the Theosophical Society. His building fund for the temple was already oversubscribed. Lamar, stung, turned on her one night and spoke sharply. The two situations were hardly comparable, he said. Sidney was dealing with a class of men who had a sense of the past and a tradition of scholarship. How well, he asked, would Master Sidney fare with the 13 precepts on a smoking car of the Illinois Central? How far would he get with his fine words on the streets of Cicero, above the din of careening beer trucks and blazing machine guns? Fanny said she was sorry, that she had not meant to goad him. She just thought he might be interested in Sidney's work. After all, they were they not, brothers in this secret order? Lamar said she was absolutely right. He asked her to forgive him for raising his voice. It would not happen again. He was, of course, pleased to hear that Sidney was doing well, and she was right to remind him of his duty. Once again, he set about in earnest to find recruits, to the neglect of his clothing sales. He told his buyers that he had something in his sample case more beautiful than painted silk neckties and more lasting than Harris tweed. And the best part was that this thing would cost them nothing more than a little hard study at night. Bates, too, pitched in anew. Through a friend at the big Chicago marketing firm of Targeted Sales Incorporated, he got his hands on a mailing list titled Odd Birds of Illinois and Indiana, which, by no means exhaustive, contained the names of some 700 men who ordered strange merchandise through the mail, went to court often, wrote letters to the editor, wore unusual headgear, kept rooms that were filled with rocks or old newspapers. In short, independent thinkers who might be more receptive to the Atlantean lore than the general run of men. Lamar was a little surprised to find his own name on the list. It was given as Mr. Jimmerson. His gossiping neighbors in Skokie, it seemed, had put him down for an odd bird. They had observed him going into his garage late at night in a pointed cap, and had speculated that he was building a small flying machine behind those locked doors, or pottering around with a toy railroad, or a giant ball of twine. He and Bates wrote letters to the 700 cranks with questionnaires enclosed that had been run off at the Latvian print shop. They waited. They sorted out the replies. Those men who seemed to have the stuff of gnomons in them got second questionnaires, and such of these as came back went through a further winnowing. The process culminated with Bates or Lamar appearing on the doorsteps of the worthy few, Codex Pappus in hand. Good morning, Lamar would say to the householder at the door. I am Mr. Jimmerson. It was during this period that Lamar, still a young man, became known to all and sundry, young and old alike, as Mr. Jimmerson. He and Bates, with gnomon gravity, had always addressed one another as Mr. Bates and Mr. Jimmerson, and this form now took hold in the wider world. Fanny continued to call him Lamar, as did Sidney Hen, and much later, Moorhead Moeller, but few others took that liberty, not even Austin Popper. Mr. Bates and Mr. Jimmerson worked long hours for the society, and even bagged a member now and then. When they were fired from their sales jobs, they hardly noticed, and they used their final commission checks to pay for a new line of printed study materials. The loss of the little brick house through foreclosure was more troubling. Mr. Jimmerson could see that Fanny was upset, and he promised to make it up to her one day. Good soldier that she was, she made no fuss. They packed their goods and left Skokie, and when they were gone, the neighbors, peering from behind curtains, spilled out of their houses and went for the garage at a trot to see what they could see. With any luck, a small airship. The Jimmersons moved into a rented room in Gary, where Fanny prepared budget meals on an electric hot plate. It was a cheerless winter. Mr. Bates often shared their dinner of baked beans and white bread spread with white oleomargarine. Neither of the two gnomons paid much heed to the Pythagorean stricture against eating beans and the flesh of animals, although they did feel guilt in the act, until Austin Popper came along and explained that this rule was never laid down by Pythagoras, but was rather an interpolation by some medieval busybody, and that in fact there was nothing Pythagoras liked better than a pot of great northern beans simmered with a bit of ham hock. The new members of the order, to be sure, paid certain fees, and the society's bank balance at this time stood at around $2,000. But Mr. Jimmerson was careful to keep that money separated from his personal funds, lest there be any breath of scandal. Fanny thought he should pay himself a small salary as master of all the gnomons in America, or at least take some expense money. Sidney didn't stint himself at his London temple. He even had a full staff of servants. Mr. Jimmerson said that Sir Sidney could do as he pleased. But as far as he, Lamar Jimmerson, was concerned, the great work was not for sale. She must understand that his position was a fiduciary one, one of trust. Fanny saw there was nothing for it but for her to take a job. She found work as a nurse's aide at Hope Hospital in the physical therapy ward, where she soon became a great favorite with patients and staff alike. After completing a brief refresher course, she took the state examination and received her license as registered nurse, along with a supervisory position in the therapy ward that paid $150 a month. Mr. Jimmerson knew nothing of this. He had noticed that they were eating better, pork chops and such, and living better. They seemed to be living in a different place, in a clean, new apartment just down the street from Hope Hospital, but he was so preoccupied that he had not bothered to inquire into these new domestic arrangements. Fanny was reluctant to tell him about the job. With all his quirky principles, he was sure to have objections to working wives. He would put his foot down. As it turned out, he didn't mind at all. And as he became swamped with paperwork, he even encouraged her to take courses in accounting and hectograph operation and lend him a hand. She did so, and with an hour snatched here and there from her busy day, she also prepared the typescripts of his first three books, 101 Gnomon Facts, Why I Am a Gnomon, and Tracking the Telluric Currents. These works, written for the general public, contained no secret matter, nor were they indexed or annotated. Things began to pick up toward the end of the decade, and then, in 1929, with the economic collapse of the nation, the Gnomon Society fairly flourished. Traders and lawyers and bricklayers and salesmen and farmers now had time on their hands. They had time to listen. And some were so desperate as to seek answers in books. By the summer of 1931, there were more than 40 pillars in six states, and in January of the next year, Mr. Jimmerson went to his Latvian printers and placed an order for 5,000 copies of the Codex Pappus. The Letts were in serious financial trouble. Their newspaper had already gone under, and the print shop was just barely afloat. But Mr. Jimmerson was not one to forget his friends. True, they had garbled important passages in his books and left pages uncut and bound entire chapters upside down, but they had also extended credit to him in those dark days when it could not have been justified in a business way. He was now in a position to return the favor. The firm was to be reorganized as the Gnomon Press. No one would be fired. The production of Gnomon tracts and books would have priority, but the shop would be free to take in outside jobs as well. When this announcement was made and translated amid heavy Baltic gloom in the back shop, the printers at first were stunned, and then they cheered Mr. Jimmerson and threw their paper hats in the air. With success came the inevitable attacks. There was the usual sour grapes disparagement and mockery of outsiders looking in. pagan nonsense, said the bishops. At best, a false science, said the academic rationalists. An ornate casket with no pearl inside, said the Masonic chiefs. A foolish distraction from the real business of life, said the political engineers. A nest of cuckoos who like to dress up and give themselves titles, said the newspaper writers. None of these gentlemen could say just what gnomonism was. The Archbishop of Chicago had it confused with Gnosticism, but they all agreed it was something to stay clear of. Why the secrecy? Who are these people? Whatever it is they are concealing must be evil. What are their long-range plans? Do they claim magical powers? What are they up to with all their triangles? Lies were spread about the gnomons. They were said to carouse in their meeting halls, which had painted windows like mortuaries, dancing the night away with much chanting and tambourine shaking, following their ritual meal of bull's blood, lentils, and smoked cat meat. There was at least one physical attack. A young man from Northwestern University tracked Mr. Jimmerson down and demanded a refund of the dollar he had paid for a copy of Why I Am a Gnomon and an apology for foisting it off on the public. He said the book was not any good at all and just awful stuff. And when Mr. Jimmerson hesitated in his reply, the young man ripped the little book into two pieces and flung them away and then punched the master in the face. Fanny did not know about the fracas until the next morning, when she noticed that her husband's lips and nose were stuck fast to his pillow with dried blood. He told her it was nothing, that he believed the young bruiser had assaulted him as a writer rather than as a gnomon, and that in any case all this abuse was contemptible, not to say futile. Their enemies were much too late. The Gnomon Society had taken root in the New World and was here to stay. This became clear for all to see on April 10, 1936, when the Gnomon Temple was dedicated in Burnett, Indiana, the most fashionable suburb of Gary. It was a mansion of Bedford limestone, which, with grounds and outbuildings, occupied a good part of the 1400 block of Bulmer Avenue, the most fashionable street of Burnett. An iron and steel tycoon, lately deceased, had built it, with little regard for expense, and his widow, eager to be off to Palm Beach, sold it to the Gnomon Society for $180,000. Mr. Jimmerson was uneasy over the prospect of moving into so grand a house, and he had to be persuaded by the Council of Three, Bates, Mapes, and Epps, that it was necessary for the master to live in the temple, at the center of the web, just as it was necessary for the temple to be monumental, have great mass, be gray and oppressive to every eye that gazed upon it. Sir Sidney Hen cabled fraternal congratulations from London. It was another wonderful day for the society, he said. He regretted that he could not attend the dedication, but his health was such that he was no longer able to travel. He was suffering greatly from fevers, fluxes, and the dry gripes, and could hardly get away from the bathroom for an hour at a time. He suspected that he was being given a debilitating poison by Rosicrucian agents from France. The cable was dated Anno 17, New Gnomon Cycle, and was signed Hen Theos Soter, Master and Hierophant, CHFSA, with the letters standing for Companion of Hermes and Far-Seeing Arbiter. Thus had the advanced degrees of gnomonry begun to proliferate. Mr. Jimmerson quickly became adjusted to the comforts of temple life. The council had been wise to insist on his living here. He particularly liked the red room with its big fireplace, the bookshelves that rose to the ceiling, the wine-colored carpet, and the wall coverings of wine-colored silk. Here he settled in. In the red room, a man could study and think. Here, he could get down to business on his new book, The Jimmerson Spiral. Fanny liked the oversized bathtubs and the canopied beds and the rose bower and the splashing fountain. She had a number of servants at her disposal, these including a cook, a gardener, two maids, and a butler chauffeur named Maceo, a quiet Negro man who had the additional duty of sweeping out the inner hall of the Black Throne, into which neither Fanny nor the maids, as females, were allowed to penetrate. Mr. Jimmerson's office was fully staffed too, and overseen by one Huggins, whose title was editorial advisor. Huggins was a journalist, an irritable, alcoholic bird of passage who brought certain professional skills to bear on the production of Gnomon printed matter. Austin Popper was the mailboy. That was the job description, but he was not really very boyish at the age of 19, or maybe it was 24, or even 30. Even at that time, Popper was coy about his age and his origins, and no one could pin him down on these things. Popper was quick, in every sense of the word. His physical movements were quick and sure, and he could learn a new task in short order and execute it with confidence. He had a ready fund of information gleaned from newspapers and popular magazines. He kept his eyes open. He remembered names. His charm was effective on both men and women, and even the misanthropic Huggins became fond of him. Maps and Epps thought him just a shade ambitious, but they too found his company pleasant, against their will. When Huggins was drunk, Popper covered for him, and when Huggins had editorial disputes with the master or printing disputes with the lets, it was young Popper who stepped in to smooth the ruffled feathers and suggest a sensible accommodation. Huggins soon found himself working for Popper, and still they remained friends. But Huggins was bound to be left behind anyway, since he refused to become a gnomon. Out of a natural perversity and a newspaper man's terror of being duped, he refused to join anything, and so remained a P.S., or perfect stranger, while Popper answered the summons with alacrity and went on to become a power in the great brotherhood. Soon he was writing speeches for the master and helping him with his books. He talked and wrote with facility, seldom at a loss for a word or an opinion. He was never master of gnomons, nor even a member of the Council of Three, but the common perception that he directed the organization was not far off the mark. What Popper did was transform the Gnomon Society. Having gained the confidence of the master, he was able to persuade him that they must broaden their appeal. The way to do this was to relax the standards. The Codex Pappus, for instance, was much too difficult for most beginners and should be revised. There was too much memory work for the ordinary man. The staggering volume of this stuff must be reduced. Only in this way could the society expect to grow and become a force in the world. Mr. Jimmerson said, "And how would you go about all this, Austin?" Popper was turning through the pages of the Codex. "The first thing we must do, sir, is get rid of some of these triangles." "You would do away with the symbolic forms?" "Oh no, not all of them. I would keep the cone of fate. Under no circumstances would I tamper with the Jimmerson spiral." "But you think there are too many triangles? The simplest of polygons?"
"Far too many, sir, for the people I have in mind.
Do you remember in school how hard it was to get anyone to join the geometry club?"
"I don't believe we had a geometry club in our school."
"Neither did we, but you see what I mean."
"The ordinary man, you say. Why should we concern ourselves with ordinary men? Plato tells us that most of them are pigs or children."
"Some of them are pigs, certainly,
But I need not remind you, sir, that it is our ancient business to transmute base matter into noble matter. The great work. As you say. All I want to do, sir, is prepare a simplified version of the Codex for use at a new and elementary level of our craft. Then, step by step, we can lead these men onto the Codex Pappus itself and pure gnomonism. Popper spoke of thousands of new members, and at last, the master came around. He took the proposal to the Council of Three, or TWK, those who know. Mr. Bates liked the idea. Mapes and Epps conceded that it might have some merit, but was Austin Popper the right person to direct such a program? He was willful, erratic. He was vain in his personal appearance. He was sometimes facetious in a most unbecoming way. In his writing, he had a vulgar inclination to make everything clear. He had not yet learned to appreciate the beauties of illusion and gnomic obfuscation. That fog was there for a purpose. He couldn't see that to grasp a delicate thing outright.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.